Oh, back in the day, you just go to, there was a couple of graffiti stores. There was a bunch of stores that would just like sell some kind of graffiti paraphernalia for the sportsmen. Scrapyard, oh yeah, that's a good place. Always a good time. Scrapyard, is it a smoke shop or is it a graffiti store? It's a little bit of both. Store that's been there forever, it's had a million different names.
It's called Scrapyard now, but it used to be called Soho Down and Under.
The Bomber System, which is now Scrapyard.
I think it's been Scrapyard continuously for a while. I mean, you used to go there in the 90s and there would be tons of people just hanging out in that block with black books. It was kind of fun. It was a meeting place a little bit more back in the 90s.
There were other people there. It was a graffiti congregation point, sort of the way Writer's Bench was in the times before.
Home graffiti supply store for Manhattan. I would say it was for the whole New York, and people from Jersey used to come to go to Scrapyard to get their graffiti supplies.
On the block of Scrapyard, right across the street on a roof, was a huge Revs and Cost paint roller. Pretty abstract, just huge, prime location to be seen by other graffiti writers.
Well, you know, it was a place where people met people for the first time and became cool.
They had markers and, you know, little knickknacks, but they sold videos and t-shirts. Most people went there for caps.
When I was in middle school, that's where I'd go to get my markers.
If you're in a paint a really good spot, you're like, I want to make sure my paint works, and that's why I would go in there and buy stuff.
But it's a store that sells graffiti stuff, and it's really one of the only places you can go to just get graffiti stuff, and it focuses on graffiti, not art supplies or anything like that. It's a relic, but it's still there. It's nice.
People would be exchanging black books, getting to know each other, sometimes getting into altercations.
From my knowledge, man, Scrapyard is definitely a home base to a lot of motherfuckers getting their ass beat. A lot of people catching up to people they had beef with.
Yeah, man, it's a cute little tourism shop for people that like graffiti. I know the people that run it, love and respect to them. They've been crushing it forever. They're a mainstay. It's a great place to pick up your graffiti starter kit.
You wanna paint a spot, you roll in there, you get some stuff that works, get the right tips, test them out, you're good to go. I mean, I'll stop by there, grab a marker or something, I guess, if I'm walking around. Even though I'm so old, I still like, maybe wanna, if I'm gonna walk up, I don't know, stop by Scrapyard and grab a marker or a mop and like walk uptown.
I still use them whenever I go to the city and I don't have a marker, I stop by.
It's what it is. That's the oldest running establishment us graffiti writers go to get paid.
But yeah, you gotta watch out. I heard people like getting bagged because Randall's car was waiting outside of Scrapyard and they start following them and stuff like that. This is a graffiti store.
And they used to sell the videograph there. Videographs, we're intrigued by that.
Videograph, those dudes were ahead of their time.
They were like pretty out there, sort of misanthropic, weirdo criminals. These guys made a point to do all this footage, so it's amazing. They're historians.
The first one came out in, I think, 1989.
Graffiti writers are faced with a terrible predicament. They're forced to either give up the art that they worked so hard for or take it elsewhere. Graffiti writers, being as resourceful as we know they are, decided to take it elsewhere, and now street bombing is the major form of graffiti art. Some writers get up anywhere they can. Any wall that'll stand still long enough will do. Some writers even take street bombing to the extreme.
Yo, I'm Nick One, this videograph 3, drop the beat.
I did submit stuff to
Spin, Nick, Sasha, Caramel Carl.
Arl Weston, I think his name was, right when he got raided. We had shit with us with the shotguns, remember? Well, we had all types of crazy footage, man. We were fucking going
We gave him a bunch of footage to put
shit,
onto videograph.
Even Baron,
and then,
too, yeah.
Yo, like, the next thing you know, all of a sudden he gets raided and everything gets taken from him and we never came out on it, yeah. So.
He got a big scandal in the 90s, like they raided his place and they confiscated all of his shit and all his footage and they tried to give him some kind of sentence for making graffiti or whatever, and then some civil rights and freedom of speech lawyers got behind him, and I think he won his case.
I'm doing an investigation.
I'm an undercover
officer. I understand that.
You put my life in jeopardy.
I want you to understand that, okay. I'm investigating your criminal activities right now. I'm investigating your criminal activities right now. I have a legal right. I have a legal right to use this footage. I have a legal right. Why don't you come and try to do another search warrant? You just to cover up your criminal activities. Your criminal activities. You have no comment, I guess. No comment? None? Okay.
Carl and Nick, you know, as producers, you know, they get arrested. You know, they get their homes raided. They get their lives turned around, you know, and turned upside down.
They open up the door. Like I said, it evolves, it changes. You know, it goes to different aspects.
Videograph is just media created by graffiti writers for graffiti writers, documenting a culture that essentially is criminal, is revolutionary, and at the time, radical and revolutionary. And Videograph was this thing where it was like, by writers, guys from the culture, documenting the culture for people within the culture. It wasn't for everybody, and that's what was great about writing, you know? It's like, you wrote not to please everyone, you wrote to speak to a very specific community of people. And that's what Videograph did in a very authentic way.
Everything was raw. Everything was just straight, edgy, hardcore. It was just that shit to where it's like, what the hell? It was just underground realism.
Hit that shit, hit it! Hit it, hit it! Fuck it!
Cat and Ghost, they were on it all the time.
Just like really early in the graffiti media landscape, people just showed it to me. And it was influential to me because I never really thought about graffiti in New York, or I'd never been to New York. It was these pretty crazy raw videos, like are the scary videos. Like I remember like this stuff, KGB crew, where they're talking about cutting people and shit. And I was just like, damn, this shit's crazy. Like
KGB mob. We're up, coming to your motherfucking town like this. Chop shop is real. Yo, this is real. See, you got KGB in a motherfucking house, and shit is just real.
All the chop shop and shit, just looking at that like, God, this shit's so real out there. You gotta just risk your whole, you gotta risk everything, just paint out there, and like, people still wanna paint, and then you see like all the cool graffiti, and you're like, damn, this. At the time when I guess I was like a teenager, I was probably just looking at that like, wow. It represented New York graffiti painting lifestyle and how it was like the danger of it and shit. It was cool. Those guys are great dudes. I met them before, and we actually tried to film a little part with me and Chase. It was just like the worst luck. It was just a very odd occurrence where like the police just seemed to be, I think they were following us or something, I don't really know. The first thing we did, we just got chased, and then immediately by like this, all these dudes in a van, or I got chased, and then immediately after that, the next thing we tried to film, the police tried to do the same thing. So we actually got rolled on the corner, that little street that was outside of Mars Bar at the other end of it, because we just were taking a mop tag on like a U-Haul. These guys were filming. It was like just the first time I had a whole backpack full of paint. We were just gonna do all this stuff on film and stuff, and like it was like kind of early, but then we were just taking a mop tag, and like the police rolled the car straight up, like get on the ground and stuff, and like we both ran, and then we ran down that street, and like they tried to run the car into Sace, tried to run it in front of him into the fence, but he ran over the top of the car and then somehow ran into Mars Bar, jumped behind the counter. The woman there was like, oh, just stay down. And then they came in there and they're like, oh, did you come in here? But and I guess those guys that filmed Videograph just got away, but they were following them, and they were following our friend that was with us too. It's funny because someone posted a video of what we did film, like this little bit that got released somewhere or something, and then someone was in the comments was like, it's like, oh my God, these guys can't even get off a tag without getting almost bagged in like 2000. I mean, I don't know why it is. That's just luck. I would never imagine that happening. It was just weird. They rolled us like so hard, but we all got away and stuff. So then we just gave up.
It was dope, yo. It was around that time when we had underground hip hop, Stretch and Bobbito was on the air. Because we saw these videos of these kids bombing and stuff like that, it made it a bit more, how can I say it? it became more of a look thing. It wasn't as much as bombing and just getting up. Now it's about how you look and how your crew looks. It was a beautiful thing for the culture. Taught a bunch of people how to dress. Copies. Everybody has a friend who has a friend who has a friend who has a copy. They'll let them borrow it. And then you have like 13 copies of the same shitty ass VHS set going around until you can't see nothing at all. And it was like, oh, somebody put Midnight Blue on this one. They should just pass them around.
My friends would watch them, or we would chip down and buy one, right? You'll have it for a couple months, then I'll get it. And it got to one point where it was like I had them all. You know, and I would watch them. What you learn from those things, what color schemes go good with each other, technique. You know, you would see a writer like use a can a certain way. But you see little techniques. And then there's people where they would watch it and develop a style from it. You know what I'm saying? Like, oh, I wondered how, oh, he starts that way and does it this way. So in other words, Videograph was teaching.
It was good to see it on film, but it takes something away too, though. It takes away the mystery. You see who that person is. I was seeing J.A. for 5 years before I ever knew he was on Videograph, and I'm glad that I saw him in the streets first, because it made more of an impression on me. It made me think, who is this person, instead of having a character, instead of seeing who he was or having a preconceived notion.
It's fun. It's a good time.
I don't know the exact years, but Graffiti hit the World Wide Web at some point.
First popular graph websites. I mean, the first one I remember was SixthSense.com. That was Drills, D-R-I-L-S's website from Queens. And I remember that was the first time I ever saw graffiti on the internet. And my mind was kind of blown, and it was all organized by writer. It was super small pictures. It was really cool, I liked it.
And the first one that I can remember that really made an impact was Tag Page. Tag Page, I believe it was run by Trip MLD. It was a page for writers by a writer. This guy appreciated graffiti, so he represented it well. Today's format, it was a click, but they had interviews and he would have photos. It was just like anything today, but.
And you had to scan pictures. These are the last days before digital cameras.
And the interviews were the best, you know what I'm saying? Because you get inside the people's minds.
The first one that I remember was Robots Will Kill.
You've got mail.
And the streets were saying things.
Art Crimes was one that we would look at super slow web connections in our, like, whatever that class was, trying to teach us about computers. In between, when the teacher wasn't looking, we would try to, like, pull up, like, pieces on Art Crimes.
There was Disaster was the first one that was interactive, I believe, where you could leave a comment. You would register, and it was, like, one picture up a day, and people would leave comments on it. And that was, but it was pretty fun. It was super interactive and a lot of shit talking. And then 12 Ounce came around. 12 Ounce was pretty fun. It really brought people together, and people, like, everyone was on 12 Ounce looking at it.
They had AOL graph chat,
and people could talk and talk shit. It was fun to watch people talk shit there on that one too.
I was just looking up my tag, on Google one day, and I saw this dust tag that I had caught. It was a picture by Graph New York curator, and it was a dust tag that I had caught in the most obscure place, and this shit was on the internet. And I'm like, yo, I never thought anyone was gonna see this. It was just a fucking dust tag in a train station in Brooklyn. Like, it was so obscure. And here's somebody who actually took a picture of this. So then I kind of started understanding. I was like, oh shit, this is like.
Really, it was even before that. It was magazines. There was a whole bunch of graph mags before anything, which they sold and bombed the system.
Oh, magazines were pretty fun in the 90s.
Stress Magazine, that was like my introduction to documentation of graffiti. Someone came to school with it and was like, yo, check this shit out. And that was because RFC was in the first Stress issue with Raekwon on it. And it was CA and Ross on the last page, like showing them racking with the Lizzie bags.
Try to grab, you can't control.
Out to Bomb.
Like, as far as magazine, that was really dope.
Mass Appeal, they were putting graph in there. Mass Appeal had some nice borough issues. I feel like, what was that, around 98, 99 maybe?
Later there was Life Sucks Die. Those kind of magazines which were in Barnes & Noble and Border.
Zines are these little homemade magazines that people make.
They're just these really niche-y, image-based bombing. Limited magazines, like very limited makes, and they're a lot of fun to look at.
I like to consume the zines. They're fun. They have a little bit more of a personal touch, a little more collectible because there's not so many of them. You're not buying something that everyone has.
But zines is a whole other world that goes beyond graffiti. But graffiti zines are really cool. I don't know anyone that has a full collection.
It's something to bring people together because when you hang out with people, you can bring a zine and they probably haven't seen it. There's so many of them.
But they don't look as nice on a bookshelf as literature, like a hardcover book on a bookshelf is more up my alley. And there's very few books on this era.
I love published books of graffiti because I think it brings some kind of relevance to sport, and it gives, you know, it gives people something to do. If you're not going to write on walls, and if you're gonna take pictures and document the stuff, it's great. It's a nice way to have a solid documentation of it. Something you can look at all the time. It's really nice. I think it definitely brings some legitimacy to the sport.
Marcel Cooper's book was like the one that was like the Bible. And even that book was traded and passed around even more than Videograph. If you had a copy of that book, believe it had like 17 different owners before you did.
The first bombing book to come out that was different from the train books, I think, was The Art of Getting Over.
One of my most favorite books of all time, Zephyr and Espo.
Espo's another one. He came from Philly to New York. He brought his Philly stuff from New York to, you know, Philly to New York, and he started doing his thing.
It showed people the different sides of graffiti. It wasn't just about the trains.
It really went in depth to explain why people do this. When he said something in the beginning about youth needing a stage to perform for their peers, and graffiti's that stage for you to perform.
And it was good. It was, everyone loved it. And people that didn't understand graffiti could read it too. It opened up a dialogue with a lot of people and recognized other people who were doing different things and who were evolving.
I guess there's been like a rush to like different publications. I know the Autograph book came out. That was pretty dope.
Oh yeah, I love Nov York. I think it's really great. I think that Nov York is one of the most important books ever. It really captures the raw aggression of growing up in New York and not having anything to do but drugs and graffiti and not having enough to do. Or that's the only thing you have. Nov York is as intense as Requiem for a Dream.
What does the million JA tags have to do with it? One of the most insightful books in terms of the psyche of a graffiti writer I've ever read. I recommend it highly. It's a word salad, but you'll definitely feel healthy after eating it.
As we can get to the base of the World Trade Center. You can see the firemen assembled here, the police officers, FBI agents, and you can see the two towers. A huge explosion now, raining debris on all of us. We better get out of the way!
Do it, Ken. 9/11 changed things tremendously with graffiti in New York.
Did 9/11 change things? Hell yeah, it did, man.
If I remember, it was a period that it was just like the blackout, or when there's a snowstorm, all the cops were downtown. So it was a good time for you to get yours in. You have to understand, that was like a real fucked up shit from New York. There was so many feelings. I think one thing that really pushes resurgence and people wanting to be more permanent is like you take something like the Twin Towers that you think is gonna survive forever and it's gone. And I don't know if you guys remember, but there was a big push with all the sitcoms and TV shows that had these B-rolls with the World Trade Center in the background to erase those. I remember watching like Friends and Seinfeld during that time. And it's like, wow, they erased the buildings. And you start to think about your own personal permeance or permanence in life. Like, how are you gonna be here? And of course, we all know that, you know, you're born, you live, then you die, then you're gone. But what gets left behind? What do you leave behind? So if anything, I think the one thing that happened with graffiti is that people wanted heaven spots more. Graffiti became more daring. They wanted to put it in spots where they knew those names, they'll be there forever. And it didn't matter how dangerous it was, but they did it. And that was another thing, because now you're looking at the NSA and Homeland Security, which basically made the city one big camera. Like, the camera's everywhere now.
A lot of things got blown. A lot of cameras went up because of 9/11.
Every corner became under surveillance. All the places that used to be the safest places to write graffiti now became target areas that cops need to look out for terrorists for. Such as subway tunnels.
There's cameras in the tunnels, which is crazy, that may not be a 24-hour circuit that's watched.
After 9/11, every subway tunnel had a camera facing inside. So if you went into a tunnel to write graffiti, it was blatant. It was just guerrilla warfare. You went in there quick, fast. You did what you had to do, and then you got out of there. Meanwhile, back in the day, Revs was writing books in there. And we would go in there, like, we would save weed to smoke inside the tunnel because it was so chill there. And this is when weed was still illegal, like, we would get arrested for smoking a blunt on the street. That was New York police state. From broken windows theory, and then 9/11, New York just became on lockdown.
You can still go in the tunnels with the emergency
exits. Yeah, but once you go into one of those exits, you walk into that hallway,
I know.
Off the ground, I think, because the fucking mice, then the rats, maybe, right?
But you could look at it, right? It's sitting there, it's set like it's a green dot in a little square box, right? So me and Lace were going through the tunnel, Lace RD. I don't know if you guys travel the subway, but you people out there know what I'm talking about when you see this shit. And the fucking light changed color. I'm like, oh, yo. I had the breakout anyway, you know what I mean? But yeah, we took a steady pace and got the fuck out of there, and that was a night. But I mean, I don't know what happened, but the thing changed color. Yeah. It went from red to green, or green to red, I don't even remember.
Graffiti writers, we're like petulant children. You can't tell us we can't do something. So now the challenge became, well, how do I get this off now? So it became more daring. And because it became more daring, it became smarter. So now these kids are doing crazy shit and getting away with it, which made it kind of amazing. But on some dark shit, it really does expose a lot of security flaws that we have in our own city. Because remember, the city became off limits to everyone. And that didn't stop us at all. We broke all those rules.
A lot of people think of New York as the 90s when it was really vibey, when you can walk down the streets in every borough and people would just be kicking it on the streets and it was fun. They weren't on their phones. The post 9/11 era was fear-based, and a lot of the construction going up and the annexing of New York City and mostly Brooklyn and carving places for rich people to hang out, they really didn't offer much. And those big apartment buildings that were only 20-30% occupied, where no one lived in them. Millionaire had a little place, they would come every 2 weeks. It was when New York City lost its vibe around 2001, 2003, around there. It just seemed like they were just buffing everything that had never been buffed. The buff trucks, it felt like they were winning because they started in about 96 and they kept upping the budget. And they were just buffing like everything, like things that, gates that have never been buffed. That, at that time in the early 2000s, I was just on a mission to, I was staying up all night with a bike and a camera, and I was going out and getting up pictures of lots of gates because all the gates I grew up looking at were just disappearing. There were certain areas I would just go on a grid and just go on every street and try to get every gate, no matter what. And if they were open, I would come back later. Seeing a lot of those gates go, they broke a lot of people's spirits, and I think they were less active.
Things looked pretty doom and gloom there for a minute, but work was still getting put in, as difficult it would be. But then New York bombers got a real curveball thrown at them.
I think that the spirit of other people coming in who weren't New Yorkers got people excited. Either they were happy or they were mad. Sometimes they were mad that these out-of-towners were doing a lot of graffiti and they weren't. And other people were, I think most people were mad actually that these, the out-of-towners were doing a lot of graffiti.
And New Yorkers didn't know how to feel about it. Honestly, we were very reluctant to accept all these newcomers. That could just be an American thing, but it really is a New York thing. You have to prove yourself here. And when all these cats from the West Coast came through, they knew that, and they did.
When I first got here, there was very few out-of-town people that were painting graffiti here. I don't know even who they were, really, or I wasn't really the best representative of where I was coming from, which is Southern California. I was kind of a novelty in a way, and I was just trying to paint a little bit, get up a little bit just for fun. But I'm glad that I came here and I was like a very new voice, because I wouldn't really like the graffiti if it was all these people that were not from here. So it was cool that I got to see a lot of New York graffiti. I didn't know anyone that came to write, so I met people that were from here from different segments of graffiti. Luckily, just by being out, met people on the street, really. And people were like, oh, that's cool, like you came here from another place. They taught me a lot, and I think that it was a cool time to be here, because later on, out of town really displaced local graffiti, and there were waves of people coming from certain cities that are opposite coast or from different cities, and they would just take over the scene.
All the Boston writers started coming here, DFM, MSK cats, crushing burners in all the piecing spots, and even on highways and all that shit, so. I mean, that shit was happening in New York, shit was happening in Jersey.
Maybe 2003, 2005, around that area.
I would imagine it corresponds with the same levels of gentrification and whatever happens in New York. I don't even know what to call this, really. Gentrification is a word, but it's just explosive economic interest in an area, in a city.
There was a huge influx of out-of-towner writers, and they were all moving to Brooklyn, really. There was always people who would come here for some reason, you know, city's a hub. But early 2000s, when Brooklyn started to become a thing, but other people were moving to Brooklyn, and it was a cultural spot. It just became overrun with all these people who had time and were writing graffiti. And people from New York City hated it, because streets were just ringing with all these people that no one knew.
So after there was all this West Coast graffiti all over the streets, it was almost like a call to arms. And graffiti was just in New York City in full force all throughout the first 10 years of the 21st century.
Slay the Drama King. Y'all know what it is, man. State your name, man. DVD, man.
I think that the out-of-towner writers that came to New York in the early 2000s, I think some of them were hipsters, and I think there was some super hipster kind of graffiti that people didn't. I think that graffiti writers from New York were mad because other people were recognizing some of these things, and there wasn't necessarily graffiti as we know it. But I think that a lot of people also moved to New York that had grown up respecting the way graffiti was done in New York, and they wanted to do it, and they were gonna adhere by the rules. But I think there was like this muddy blurring where people didn't really understand the difference between them. Everyone just seemed like out-of-towners, and everyone out-of-towners were bad. It was just xenophobia. And then I think there was a point when people started to embrace the fact that other people who weren't from New York City were actually writing graffiti, and that New York City was a real destination.
I would meet out-of-town writers in different spots, in different parties, lounges, Lower East Side, even Chelsea, you know what I'm saying?
I met a lot of out-of-town writers.
And it was kind of a point where it was like a handshake moment in the late 2000s. The out-of-towners reached this equilibrium with the New York City writers. And then we started to see a lot, like late 2000s, it really started to come back a lot. I don't really fully understand what a hipster is. I think a hipster is someone that is trying to make their living or carve a path for themselves in a non-traditional way.
There was always hipsters coming to New York. In the 80s, you know, what were the people who came to the East Village? Those were hipsters, right? And people want to blame this or that for gentrification and all this bullshit, but things change and you just got to accept it. Right, what about the 80s? What were the people, the artists who came in, they weren't hipsters? Yeah, of course.
The hipsters, people who move from other states, come here, take over Brooklyn, and try to dress like whatever they want, like wear different colors that don't match, and Crocs with a hat tipped to the back. It's just weird, I don't know, they dress funny.
I used to think that hipsters were people that moved to New York City, and then I realized that some people I know that grew up in New York City are hipsters, and I realized that it's just someone that's trying to do something differently and go against the system, really.
And then they're like, wait a minute, you can't be a hipster. I was like, why not? Because you're a New Yorker. You invented everything you could be trying to bite off. I was like, oh, cool. Everybody tries to hate on hipsters, and they try to pigeonhole all these kids in like these different squares. And I'm going to keep it 100 with you guys. That's our fault. We did that shit. We made New York cool, painted all over shit, started a whole scene, made the Village cool. Those photos got out there. People saw how we were living, and they wanted to come over and be a part of it. And then they brought their own flair. They said, like, yo, Travis trucker hat on. And you know what? Shit was pretty fucking dope. Not mad at it. With all things, art follows the streets. Money follows the art. Shit happens. People came over here. We made New York a great place. I mean, yeah, there are arguments about gentrification and people being pushed out and blah, 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 blah. But people don't really say, well, who sold out? There's like a whole thing about the cultural identity and the neighborhoods and stuff like that. But New York is always a forever changing thing. The New York that I dealt with in the 90s wasn't the New York that I experienced in the 80s. And it wasn't my mother's New York in the 70s. And the 2000s were weird for everybody. And New York is a growing, evolving city. We still have subcultures that still pertain to their natural roots and elements. You just have to find them. The hipsters, if you want to call them the kids that moved in here, but no, we were the original hipsters. Motherfucker that made the tight jeans song was Ninja Sonic from Brooklyn. That wasn't a motherfucker that came from somewhere else. That was us here. We started it. It was graffiti writers that were moving to the Tibbin Lofts and certain spots in Bushwick first and painting up the neighborhoods. And like, okay, my bad, the rent's been up, but the intentions were good.
Mark Echo knows all about promotion. This block party proves it.
It was a throwback to the 80s yesterday when a group of graffiti artists made their mark in Chelsea.
They fought for their right to party. Today's Graffiti Fest was almost canceled.
But the mayor says, no way, it's going to encourage vandalism. Now the designer is suing.
despite the objections of Mayor Bloomberg.
The judge says withholding the permit is a violation of the First Amendment.
But a federal judge ordered the city to lighten up and allow the event.
Mark Echo, the man with a vision and a video game to sell.
You got all the kids that were playing video games when that video game came out, that they didn't do graffiti, when that video game came out, and if they played that video game, made them want to do graffiti writers. 100%. We had a block party on 22nd Street, which is in my neighborhood, in Chelsea. I didn't know anything about this block party. I was on the High Line, breaking light, painting on the High Line, the night before the block party. And I remember walking to the, hearing noise, like people building some shit. And I walked to the 22nd Street side, and I seen the train panels that they were putting up for graffiti, for like the OGs to paint, you know, replica size panels of New York City trains. And I was like, yo, woke up in the afternoon, you know, get up, and one of my homies from my block was like, yo, Mark Echo has a block party going down right down the block, and they're doing graffiti right now on fucking panels of trains. I went with my camera, I had my fucking power shot camera, and yo, I got, like, it was my first time seeing, like, Ghost, Lady Pink, first time me seeing Lady Pink. Honestly, man, I can't run through all the names off over the top of my head. I seen people get bagged by Vandal Squad that day. Shit was crazy, man. But it was dope, man. Like, people brought their black books out. Everybody was signing their black books. I think that was like one of the biggest moments in graffiti in Manhattan.
Now I think if you're an outsider and you come here, I don't know if it really means that much. It's like people painting these murals, but it's like the worst thing I've ever seen. That's why I'm really glad that I moved out of Bushwick. And it's like, even though I like Berlin, like I just oh man. Street art is like really ruined Europe, I'll tell you that. That's what it is. And it ruined Bushwick.
Street art is not graffiti.
Street art is not graffiti, and I really hate when people say, look at that graffiti, and I'm like, it's not graffiti, it's street art. But I think there's some element of bombing, because there is some element of risk, meaning that someone might kick your ass, or you might get arrested or spend the night in jail. But is it like bombing as everyone wants to call it bombing? I don't think so.
It's not bombing, it's different. Like, if you're not spray painting straight on the fucking wall, bombing, it's not graffiti. Street art. If it's not traditional, if you didn't do tags, a throwy, straight letter, burner, illegally, shit is not graffiti.
But there is an element of risk. And street art is also about, a lot of people are actually trying to make their name as an artist, whereas graffiti writers are not trying to make their name as an artist. So I think that it depends on what your ultimate goals are with that. In street art, people are just copying the Basquiat model. I don't know if Basquiat and Herring were the first street artists, but I think that they were some recognized as some, and they also were affiliated with a lot of graffiti writers.
Samo was throwing his tag up like as a graffiti writer would. So Basquiat throwing up Samo. So
the fact that Basquiat actually had a tag and dabbled in both gives him some credibility.
I would say street art is something that you got permission for. You got time to hang out in the street and do your art.
It's more art. People get permission, they get ladders, and they can stay there all day doing it slowly. And it's cool too, but it's not like bombing.
Graffiti is a medium, but bombing, that's a totally different thing. Our shit involves running from fucking cops.
If you only do permission spots, you are not a graffiti writer.
If you don't gotta fucking run from a cop, it's street art. Even if you're doing arrows and blems, all that shit, it's fucking street art.
Luckily, I don't live in a neighborhood where there's street art.
Right? But then again, this is the catch-22. There's a lot of writers that caught legal issues because of all the bombing and painting they did. So they were forced to become street artists.
Some permission spots are thought of as cool by bombers, but a lot of permission spots get taken out by bombers, and it's almost expected. It's been happening since the days of Scene and Cap.
You gotta prove yourself in the streets. And if you prove yourself in the streets, then there's a code of respect.
It's like, come on, man. Leave it to the real people.
Chill, chill.
Can you tell me about Zexor and his anti-mural campaign? You know of it?
The best shit ever. Shout outs to him. Rest in peace, Zex. I love you. Yeah, he didn't give a fuck about that shit. He went to war with, what was the name of that group again? Bushwick something. The Bushwick Collective, yeah. And he took them to town until like they apologized and they started to make efforts.
And Zexor was on a mission to not let any legal permission spots in his neighborhood rock.
Oh, well, I guess he felt, you know, that he didn't like the fact that the gentrifiers were coming to his neighborhood of Bushwick.
He was born and raised in Brooklyn, you know, in Bushwick. Things changed in Bushwick since the time he was born.
So he took matters into his own hands. He didn't like the street art. He didn't like the fact that they were going over graffiti, you know, so he wanted to bring some old school flavor back to the neighborhood. That's how I see it.
He was a cool dude. I used to go to his bar a couple of times, and he used to work in Bushwick at the bar. He was a cool dude. He was very cool, very nice. I met him in a train one time, and he's like, "Yo, you right?" I was like, "Yeah, I'm Kiko." He's like, "Oh shit, what's up? I'm Zexor, or Roxas." I was like, "All right, cool. I've seen your shit." And then we never exchanged numbers, but we saw each other again like 3 or 4 times after that, which is weird, because we met in a 7 train. I know he had a girlfriend up there in Queens somewhere, I think. Which is pretty cool, but RIP to him. Sucks that he passed. He was a cool dude.
Thanks for sharing.
One of the photos that I have that I took of Zexor was actually with the homegirl, Daniela. Danielle, who did the Biggie mural that's still there. And out of all of them, that's the only one he didn't cross out. He respected that one. And I remember I got them together and I brought up that whole thing as a joke. And it was like a funny thing to see because she was part of that Bushwick Collective. Those kids were going nuts over it. They didn't know what to do with themselves. Because also, Zexor was a Godzilla. You were the fucking with Zexor. And then to see them talk about it and laugh, because there was a mutual understanding in terms of how he felt. Because the way he felt, like there was a lot of old school graffiti. And remember, his dad, he's a graffiti legacy. Because his dad was also a 501 crew, ass WTO. They were up all over the place. They were going up over all these walls in Bushwick that had these legendary names on there without paying any respect and just changing the name and creating this whole tourism shit. He was on some anti-gentrification league shit. He was like, fuck that. Total respect to him. It was also like, I remember as it being like the best thing that happened in social media because everybody loved that shit. He was like our Robin Hood or something like that, you know? He became like our anti-hero, which was a beautiful thing.